It's always good to be able to come in and praise his name.
Yes.
One of the things that I love about the early morning when you get up and get ready for the day's activities is spend time with the Lord. Mm-hmm. There's something about that prepares you for today. We don't know what's going to happen during the course of a day, but we know the Lord's there.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I know the pastor mentioned before, but I remember reading our daily bread. They used to pass out. Now you can download the app. You can have it every day.
Yeah.
I got it on my phone. And one thing was, I remember reading it years ago, don't worry about tomorrow. God's already there.
Yeah.
And one of our things, I think, as believers, we have to really get to that point and realize that God is already there. God was in our past. He's in the present.
Yes.
And he's in the future.
Yep.
And he has plans out. Plans made for us. Now, this is Romans 8:28. One thing I love about the Bible apps is that they give different versions of the same verse. And I love, and it's always seemed like there's always a new one that comes up. But one thing I like, we talk about Romans 8:28. And this is a New Living Translation. And we know that God causes everything to work together for good of those who love God and are called toward his purpose for them. And another translation is, I really like this too, is that just this, a New Heart translation is pretty close, New Heart English. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God. That's really the key. It's those who love God to those who are called according to his purpose. And one thing about it is that sometimes we think that the things in our life that seem like such a mess, even when you're still, you made decisions that wasn't the best, the one thing about it, God was still there.
Yeah.
You know, God, that's what I love most about God. The situation with driving a truck, sometimes you turn down some streets and you found out that, you know what, probably shouldn't turn down the street. It wasn't necessarily somebody's fault. We had this happen. I kind of shared it a little bit on Wednesday, but we was going down Martin Luther King. We made a left on Southwest 3rd by the baseball field, and there was a sign as you turn that says the right lane closed, which that was sort of accurate. Okay? The reason it wasn't accurate, the whole street was closed. Okay? Well, we got our semi down there with students. And you had to make a left. If you've been down there, you got to make a quick left. There's a left turn lane. It's not made for a truck.
Right.
Okay? So, you know, the student down there said, it's no problem. You know why it's no problem? I'm looking at this and said, already been through situations like this. It looked bad. Obviously, we couldn't back all the way back out. Mm-hmm. So, tell you what I'm going to do. I'm getting on the ground. Mm-hmm. Okay? I'm going to lead you through this turn. Because you know what? I've already been through terms like this.
Yeah.
That's what God is telling you today.
Yes.
See, he's already been through these things.
Yeah.
He knows how it feels to be rejected.
Come on.
You know, he knows how it feels to cry. You know, he knows how it feels to have a family member pass away.
Yeah.
He knows how it feels to hurt and the frustration. You know, I still go back to this. I still think the saddest scripture in the Bible, and it always gets me every time, is when the Bible talks about all the disciples forsook him and fled.
Right.
That to me, it just hurts me so much.
Yeah.
Every, you know, I read that and it just, your tears welled up to think that they had been there with him all that time when he needed them. You know, they fled, and fled means they're not just walking off,
yeah,
they're running off.
Yeah.
You know? And then you think about Peter, who denied that he didn't even know him.
Yeah.
You know? But I love Jesus. You know, sometimes some people are small. You know, they always bring up petty stuff. They're always going.
Oh, yeah.
But one thing about Jesus, you ever notice? Jesus never said to Peter, not one time. He said, you know, Peter, I really don't appreciate you doing that.
Yeah.
You know, disciples, I don't appreciate y'all. So he never brings it up. You know what Jesus does? I love you.
Right. Yes.
I love you.
Right.
And that's the way we should always be.
Exactly. Right.
Now, when we look at this scripture, I'll read one more verse, and then I want to read from Psalm 72. And we now know, this is Jubilee Bible 2000, we now know that unto those who love God, all things help them unto good to those who are according to the purpose are called to be saints. Boy, I love that. And we know So that's what Paul said, to know him. Yes. There comes a point, you know, you got to know whom you believe.
Exactly.
Well, you got to set up a standard and say, this is what I believe.
Right.
And come to that point and say, you know what? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Right.
You know, if somebody asked me, you know, Tim, do you believe in Jesus Christ? You bet I do.
Right.
I'm not going to think about it. I'm not going to hesitate about it.
Right.
I believe
right.
in what God says.
Right.
In Psalm 72 and verse 17, it says, his name shall endure forever. His name shall continue as long as the sun. Indeed, his name continues before the sun. And men shall be blessed and bless themselves by him. All nations shall call him blessed.
Yeah.
Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things.
Yes.
Blessed be his glorious name forever. Let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen, amen.
Yeah.
That's where we want to come to today. That's where we want to come to today. So it matters not what you're going through, all that stuff you're going through. Realize the one that's walking through there with you. See, that's the big thing. You don't have to be scared. You know, sometimes we get fearful. We don't understand. And God says, I'm with you. What else can I say? A lot of times you hear, as Jesus talks, if they only just believe me.
Right.
It's almost a cry of his heart. Just believe me.
Right.
The one that, you know, we sang a song. He's got the whole world in his hand.
Yeah.
You know, we sang it when he was little coming up. I still believe that song.
He's
got the whole world in his hand, and he's not going to drop it.
No, sir.
You know, isn't it interesting? I like studying science and stuff, too. Isn't it interesting? As you get the Hubble scope, and they're looking out farther, it gets up, and they see that, hey, there's a lot more universes out there.
Yeah.
You know? And it keeps going on and on. You know, it's bigger than they thought it was.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, who did that? Who created that?
Exactly.
That's what I love about God. When God created the earth, you know what he said? Star, when you stay right there until I tell you otherwise.
Yeah.
You stay right there.
Uh-huh.
Yet when he created, he spoke. He
right.
spoke the world in existence.
Right.
That same God can speak power in your life. He can speak
yes.
deliverance in your life.
Yes.
He can just speak it.
Yes.
So many times that's what he wants. Just believe.
Right.
You know, and sometimes you remember the one guy came and said, just speak the word. You don't have to go, Jesus. I'm telling you, you don't have to go. I remember, if you don't have to go, just speak. And I know he'll be healed.
Right.
Because I understand authority. When I tell them to go, they go. I understand. You just speak that word,
yes.
and he'll be healed.
Yes.
And that's what happened.
Yes.
And that's what God wants us to do. Speak his word.
Yes.
You know, so many times people say, well, you know, God never speaks to me.
Yes.
Well, he speaks to me all the time.
Yes.
You got 66 books.
Yeah.
That he's speaking to you all the time. Take the time to read his word.
Yeah.
This is the manual right,
yeah.
right here.
Yeah.
You know, one person, I know I shared this before, one person said, you know what Bible stands for, Tim? I said, what does it stand for? I'm trying to remember what he said. Basic instruction before leaving earth.
Yeah.
B-I-B-L-E.
Yeah.
Basic instruction before leaving earth.
Yeah.
He would tell, and that's it.
Yeah.
That's the manual.
Yeah.
How do you get through this life? It tells you right here. It talks about forgiveness. Talks about dealing with your neighbor. Talks about business still. It talks about right here.
Yeah.
You know, how to get salvation.
Yeah.
It talks about this. How to love your neighbor. That's so important.
Yeah.
You know, how to look down inside yourself and see where your own heart's at.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Right.
You know, and so many times, if we would seek this first, before we make our decisions, how much easier life would be. It doesn't make any difference what it is. I don't care if it's going to this store, that store, buying a car, going,
right.
living in that neighborhood. God knows where you're supposed to be at.
Right.
God knows whose neighbor you're supposed to be, the place where you work. There may be one person God wants you to touch
right.
at that place. That's why I want to work. So, well, I don't understand, God, why this job fell through. I don't understand, man. I had all the qualifications. I
right.
had the education. I know I could do this job. God said, no, wait, I need you over here.
Right.
Are you my servant or not?
Right.
See, one thing I know about parents, they like the parents like their kids to do what they ask them to.
Yeah.
They do like that. You know, son, you go clean up your room.
Yeah.
You know? Oh yes, mom. Not a problem. Mm-hmm. See that sounds good, right?
Yeah.
Would you go to the store for me? No, mom, no problem. Okay, it's hard sometimes and well I'll get around to it, Dad.
Yeah.
You know? Next thing you know it's 10 o'clock at night. You know, I asked you at 8 o'clock this morning, are we going to get around to the day? Yeah, we got plenty. plenty of time. You know, the store closed at 10:15, you know, or 10:30. They can even get going a little bit for stores closed. But they liked an obedience. And that's what they said. You know, obedience is greater than sacrifice. When God asks you to do something, that's what I'm learning in my life right now. When God asks you to do something, and I love the missus because she understands that.
Yeah.
She absolutely understands. I've had more blessings because she's been in my life. Because
yeah.
She understands that. When God says do this, we'll just do it. God says write a check over here. We had a lady I used to go to church with, and her daughter-in-law was going on a mission field, and she sent us, said, why don't you contact her and see if y'all want to get involved in ministry. So I talked to the missus. You know what the answer was? Man, that was the best answer ever. Sure. Here's a young person willing to dedicate themselves on the mission field. What, you know, I mean, we talked with her, and we talked about her attitude and talked about what she wanted to do. Let's do it. Let's write a check. Because you don't know. When you got somebody totally sold out to God, right, what can they do for God?
Right.
When somebody is, you know, I'll tell you what, that's living wide open. I mean, they put the hammer down, as the old truck driver said, and we're going straight on.
Yeah.
We're on that track, and we're going straight on. That's what I love about Paul. I'm not saying Paul didn't have time for reflection, but Paul understood one thing. He is Christ that lived him, not wasn't Paul anymore. It wasn't the old Saul that used to persecute the church. What it was, now I have Paul.
Yes.
I got the power from God.
Yes.
I'm going to go out. Because you ever notice something? When Saul got converted to Paul and became Paul, God didn't take his zeal away. You ever notice that? He didn't. He just had it misdirected.
Right.
God said, now, you done tried to, you know, you persecuted me. You persecuted all my children. You persecuted. Now what we're going to do, we're going to turn that around. So now you're going to build up my church rather than tear it down.
Right.
And look at Paul's life. He often talked about that man. When he got knocked off and he couldn't see, he cried, who thought, Lord? You know, he cried, Lord. He cried, Lord.
Right.
What do you want me to do? And then what do you want me to do? Because
right.
Paul thought he was just persecuting Christians. You're persecuting me, Paul. That's what you're doing. Okay, but from now on, you're a chosen servant.
Right.
And look at Paul's life after that. Boy, he didn't back down anywhere.
Right.
He didn't back down. Right. Clear to the grave. He didn't back down. He knew who he belonged to. So as we go in the prayer and as we go and praise God today and just remember the prayer request, obviously, you know, Christians, we have our election coming up Tuesday. That's an important thing to pray about.
Mm-hmm.
We're supposed to pray for a leader. Whether we agree with them or not, we're still supposed to pray for them.
Right.
And all the situation with the police and all the kids that are no longer with us and all the things that's happening, we need to pray, folks. You know, because one thing about it, when we see somebody in the newspaper that passed on, that could have been our kid.
Right.
That's what we always got to think. You know, just that we look at a person kind of, well, they're not really in our family. Yes, they are. They're part of the human race.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And they're part of our family.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to think of it. That would change things around if that was your son or daughter.
Mm-hmm.
That would change things. So that's always looked at, that we are part of the human race and we're going to look at and pray for the human race.
Yeah.
So we're going to go ahead and open this time up to praise the Lord. Let's praise the Lord. Because now is the time to praise the Lord.
Right.
Don't wait. That's
right.
One thing God put on my heart too. Don't wait to pray for somebody.
Right.
Don't wait to lift them up.
Right.
Don't wait to contact them. If God put somebody on your heart to say, you know what, you need to have a conversation with them.
Yeah.
God knows where they are on the other end. They may be in wait for somebody to tell them, hey, you know what? I just want to tell you, I appreciate your friendship, and I'm praying for you.
Amen.
They may have been waiting. God, I just got to know if somebody cares for me. There's a lot of people in this world that don't have that. You know, we thank God for our families and everything, but some people are so lonely
that
they don't have anybody,
right.
You know, that feel like cares about them. And then, you know, when God asks you, that can make all the difference in their life at that point. So we're going to go ahead and open this prayer session up, and pray session. Yes.
I'd just like everybody to remember me on Wednesday. I have back surgery.
Oh, yes.
They're going to inject cement into my back.
Oh.
Tammy's going to know if it was quickly.
Oh.
But just remember me Wednesday.
Yes. We definitely would. I understand that back surgery. I've had it in the 90s, and it worked. I mean, that's one good thing about it. You know, I've been fortunate and blessed, but we're definitely going to pray. I know when they open you up, we'll pray for you. God.
Cindy's healing. Thank the Lord for her healing. Thank the Lord for Myron's healing. And I thank the Lord that watched over my son-in-law. He got was watching, defending his sister Friday night late. It shouldn't have been out that late anyway. Anyway, he got somebody caught behind him and stabbed him twice. Once in the torso, and, or once in the arm and once in the torso. The arm one is more serious than the back one. But anyway, he's out of the hospital. He's home, but he has to go back in and do surgery on the arm. It, he needs the Lord. So I'm praying and thanking the Lord for his salvation right now, because he's going to accept the Lord before this is over with.
Wow. And that's your son?
Son-in-law.
Son-in-law. Wow.
Here in Des Moines.
Wow.
Friday nights.
Wow. Yes.
Healing for my daughter, and my cousin has some sinus things going on, and I invited her to church this morning, and I think she would have came, but she wasn't feeling good. So pray for her healing, and thank the Lord for her soon coming visit.
Okay.
Amen.
Daughter. Yes. Think that's important. You know, it's always good to talk about the grace of God. You know, it's always good to let people know how much they're loved and cared for. And to be a negative person or dwell on bitterness just doesn't get you anywhere.
Yeah.
Right. What it does when you rise higher in that situation. You know, I always think about how Jesus handled people and how they was drawn to him. He just had so much compassion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he just had a person. And I want to share this because it's just something the Lord put on my heart, and I know it was a drama activity, but it really changed my life. We went to they was doing the passion play one year, and I had my daughters with me and run a little bit late trying to get all dressed, and they closed the sanctuary part. They had this glass, so we had to sit out in the lobby there. And so they was taken. They took Jesus off the cross. We saw that part. And then they was going to show him resurrected. Well, he obviously went down to the basement, and he came back up, and he had this shining white robe on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know it was just the play, but he had this shining white robe on. And I'm sitting at the end of the pew. They had some pews out there. And I'm just looking at this whole thing. And he turned, this actor turned to me, and he smiled at me. And he was getting ready to go inside, and they waved him off. They wasn't ready for him yet. And he came over to the same bench and sat beside me,
mm-hmm.
and smiled at me. And I just something that's years ago. That changed my heart forever.
Yeah.
I know it was just an act, but he came over and he smiled, and it's like Jesus was sitting there.
Yeah.
And it's like I get pitched. That was Jesus, not just an actor.
Right.
He cared enough to come over and sit with me.
Yeah.
And that forever changed my life, you know. And it's like he wanted to be my friend.
Right.
He wanted to be part of my life.
Right.
He knows your creator. We understand that part. But when he came over and sat out and he turned and looked at me and smiled at me, it's like he was happy with me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I look back on that incident and realize, you know what? That's how much God loves you.
Right.
When the word says, I love you with an everlasting love,
right,
that's what it means.
Yes.
That means it's never going to stop.
Right.
God's love for you is never going to stop.
Right.
If you don't ever remember anything in your life, don't ever forget that. Because that's where people get off on a lot of things. So, I don't know if God loves me. Yes, he does. He said it in the word.
Yes.
I love you.
No,
you know, no matter what. Good, bad, ugly, no matter. I will love you with an everlasting love.
Yes.
Never forget that.
Thank you, Lord.
Never.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Yes.
Robert Red sends his greetings, and he's not quite recuperated from the shot. That he got so he wouldn't get sick, you know. Well, it had a reverse effect on him, and so he's maybe figured on being here next week, but we remember him induced sickness. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll definitely do that. We'll pray for him.
Amen.
We understand that. Okay, yes, you.
So yesterday I went to get a massage, and if you ever do that, you know, sometimes you're trying to help the person, and they're like, would you just relax and let me have control of this? And so I'm laying there on the bed, and I was thinking of Pastor, how many times he's told us to rest, you know, and it's really hard, especially when they hit those lumps or those tissues, and you jump and you fence, and it's like, it's okay, just, I got to break this down, you know?
Sure.
And I think, you know, the Lord just reminded me, you know, you're in my hands, just
yes.
like you're in her hands.
Right.
She's going to make you better. She's going to get this toxic junk out of you, and that's what I'm always trying to do. And, yeah, you feel some pain, and, you know, you hear some bristles and things that you didn't even know was in there. But it just kind of reminded me, and the Lord just says, you know, this is the way I'm trying to do you. I'm just
yes.
trying to mold you and make you.
Right.
And you keep resisting me when I'm telling you to relax and it's all going to be okay. So
yes.
I don't know. That was just a good analogy.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah,
amen.
That's good. Amen. Amen.
I had a guy I was working with named Mike. His wife, Mariah, has cancer.
Oh.
They are hardcore Muslims. So I want her touched.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. We're going to definitely pray for that. Thank you.
I got another friend named Jimmy.
Yeah.
He's not doing good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And that's, this is a great place to bring those prayer requests.
Yes.
You know, God's people. You said
right.
if they're touching their green, two or three touching their green,
right.
I'll be in the midst.
Yes. Yes.
That's what's important, Jesus. Yes.
My sister-in-law, Mary, is in the last stages of cancer. They pulled the group that comes in the last stages.
Hospice. And who was it again?
Mary.
Okay. Yeah. Got it. Yes.
Our aunt, which is my dad's sister, was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer.
Yeah.
And they're saying that it's there, it's in her shoulder, and another place, I can't remember, but healing for her. She believes in Christ, so.
Yeah. Yep.
Yep.
Yep. And he's a healer.
Yes, he
is. Yes.
Joe, are you going to show what your brother Joe experienced with that lady's foot?
Oh.
Come on.
Do I have that? Yeah. Anyway.
Talk about it.
Yeah, my brother Joe, he prayed for a lady that had diabetes in her foot. They were going to amputate it he saw her a week before they were planning to amputate it. The Lord put her on his heart. He refused to go forward and pray for her. 2 days later, he saw her again. So he's like, Lord, I know this is what you need me to do. So he walked up and prayed with the husband, the wife, prayed for her foot. I mean, she had like this sore on her foot, open wound. And just day by day, it's been getting better and better. So God touched her. And I know he's a great physician, so he can heal all of what we're talking about today.
Right.
Right.
But yeah, it does. It gives you confidence. I forgot all about that. But yeah, he posted some pictures of when he prayed for her foot.
That's why it's important to be obedient.
Yes.
To what God asks you to do.
Right.
Because it's not our power.
Right.
You know.
Right.
It's the power that worketh in us. Because greater he that is in us than he that is in the world.
That's right.
So, yes, John.
Yeah, I appreciate people mentioning others, and that's what we're supposed to do, is think of others more than ourselves, or at least as much as we think of ourselves. And the sacrifice, Veterans Day is coming up, so
right.
I just want to mention how thankful we should be as a nation for all those that have served. Protect us all, and went and saw a really good movie concerning a veteran theme, you know, of war, and this medic, he was conscientious objector, he wouldn't touch a weapon because he didn't want to kill, he wanted to save, and so his mission was to just bring others back to life instead of leaving them out in the field, and that's what he did. He wasn't thinking about his own life. He was willing to sacrifice like we should in the war that God's got going on with the enemy. You know, there's a lot of people out there that need to be rescued, and we should not be thinking of our own safety, but we should be willing to go out there and lay down our lives like the Lord did, you know, serve him that way. And just wanted to lift up all the prayer requests, all that we can do for God and service to him and what he's done for us, and thank God for our veterans, and just praise the Lord.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank the Lord.
That's good.
Thank the Lord.
That's good. That is so good. Years ago, pastor used to tell me that's what joy is. Jesus first, others, you. You know, yourself. And I think that's so true. Lift him up first and think of others. Because Jesus was always thinking about others. What always got me was when he's on the cross and all the stuff, the whippings that he took, and he's on the cross, and you know, and to say, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do.
Right.
And his mother was right there. No, John, you take care of him. I mean, he was always thinking of others.
Yeah.
And I just thought, how? I mean, it would have been such, at that point, to turn inside, you know, and then when the thief on the cross said, repent, remember me, you know, and Jesus could have said, I got a lot going on here, but he said, no, today, you're going to be with me in paradise today. That tells you that's his heart, and we know, and he died like this. I love when you see it, when you see he died like this, his arms are open. He says, come here, come unto me, arms open, I love you this much. You know, you take what I did for you, I love you. If you don't take what I did for you, I'm still going to love you. Okay? All right. Let's go ahead and stand up for prayer, please.
Thank you, God.
Oh, hallelujah. God, you are good. Thank you for dying for us on the cross and giving us a life. Oh, Lord, these needs that are here today, that you would meet every need that we have. Our sister Sally, that you would touch her. She goes into surgery. Lord, that you could just totally make that good, sir, everything will work out. You're good, Lord. Father God, you would touch her back. Oh, hallelujah. For Sydney, that total healing. For Myron, Robert Red, hallelujah. Oh, the situation with son-in-law that got stabbed, Lord. Oh, how horrible is that? The healing of the daughter and have a visit, the cousin and the aunt that has this cancer. And Lord, the election, oh, hallelujah, that Lord, that this Lady Mariah at a workplace, that Lord has cancer, we're claiming a healing right now. Hallelujah, because you are a name above every name. And you're a name, the name is cancer. You're above every name. Every name, that includes cancer. That includes anything that's not of you. That you died, hallelujah, for us to provide that healing. Hallelujah. You are the God that heals. You are the God that delivers. You are the God that can provide a way when others said there is no way. Father God, we ask you, Lord, to bring grace. Grace, Lord, to all these things that happen. Lord, our work situation, those people that are not doing very good. Today is going to be your turning point. That we're going to lift up a standard. Hey, say no more, no more, no more. Because we serve a Christ Hallelujah. That wonderful, that is a Father, that is a precious Savior, the one that delivers, the one that's still healing, the same God. Hallelujah. As the disciples was looking up and you went up into heaven, they said this same Jesus, the same one today, yesterday, and forever. Father God, we want to thank you. We want to praise you today that we can come in this house. We can lift you up. The Bible said if you be lifted up, you draw all men unto you. Father God, there is nothing too hard for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can, hallelujah. That impossible situation. That impossible situation. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just let our souls say yes. Let our souls say yes. Let us remember that you are the potter. We are the clay. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Because it's all about you. Lord, take out anything out of our life that's not like you. Let us reflect who you are. And Paul said, oh, that I may know him. That I may know him. Let us know you in a richer and deeper way every day. Let us not leave this house of worship the same way we came in. That there's something different. Hallelujah. That joy would just bubble out. That we have to go out and tell somebody that you know what? This is what Jesus did for me. And you know what? This is what Jesus can do for you. And Father God, we thank you that we can pray today. We thank you that we can come here and worship. We thank you that we can call you Holy Father. Oh, hallelujah. The Bible said, when there's two or three touch and agree, you be in the midst. And wherever you are, it's holy ground. Hallelujah. And Lord, we want to thank you, we want to praise you. We want to lift you up because you are God. In the beginning, God. Hallelujah. You're the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. No matter where we may go, you're going to be with us. So Lord, as we continue in this service, let your Holy Spirit have the right of us. Because it's all about let our worship go up long past this ceiling and all the way up to the throne room. Lord, we thank you and we praise you in your wonderful holy name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. House of Prayer this Friday, November 11th.
Amen. Just going to be focusing on the Lord. I know Tuesday is a critical time in this nation, and the bride of Christ has a job to do. Whoever gets in office, we need to pray for them. The course, I believe, in this nation is being changed, and I know it's because of the people praying. Pray that we all come together to seek the Lord's face and seek his revelation.
There, so you can sign up what you're going to bring. So we'd like all of you to join us.
Yes.
Okay, now we're going to speak the word. Okay. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs will follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse.
exalt you, God. Fervently worship you with thanks, God, for all that you do for us. We pray for this offering, God, and the opportunity to give for others, God, of ourselves and what you've blessed us with. Pray your blessing upon the offering, God. Multiply it for the service today, God. Help us, Lord, with all of our hearts to be involved mightily in this service and worship of you. For you are worthy, Lord God, you are great, greatly praised. In the holy name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. let's just thank the Lord for what he's already done.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Whatever your need was today, whatever it may be, just believe God right now. Believe that it is finished. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness, for your love, for your mercy, your grace. Thank you, Lord, for your compassion. And thank you, Lord, that you foresaw every need that we would have in our entire lives. And you supplied it. And you are there, Lord. Wherever we find ourselves, you, Lord, are in the midst of it.
Yes.
We give you all the thanks and the praise in the lovely and perfect name of Jesus. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give him a hand tonight. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Kids here for Sunday school can go downstairs. Don't forget the envelope back there. Whenever you leave, try to put a little something in there for Myron. He'll really appreciate it. And you know, that's what the Lord said. Whatever you give, a glass of water, or you're giving it to him. Praise the Lord. So just assume that you're giving it to Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Mike and worship team. As always, great job. Thanks, everybody, for your testimonies and sharing your prayer requests and praying for one another. Thank you, Tim, for opening and sharing your remarks, God's word, and it's all good. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So, we've got a big week ahead of us. Weather is perfect. It couldn't be any better for November, that I can recall anyway, and it's all good. Just a couple of things. You know, two wrongs don't make a right, but two rights did make an airplane, so praise the Lord. Everybody just lighten up now, hallelujah. God's in a good mood, amen. He's healing, he's delivering, he's doing all that God alone can do, praise God. Yes? Myron Pease, P-E-A-S-E. You know, there's not a lot of things that I really get wild about, but I do enjoy long romantic walks to the fridge. I'm using that as a verb, you know, or a noun, actually, and an adjective. So, yeah, romantic walks to the fridge. I always get worked up over that. Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing this morning? Praise God. Everybody doing all right? Hallelujah. That one song just freaked me out. I was talking to Buddy before. I said, I swear, I'm waiting for Meatloaf to break out. Every time that song is, you guys do that song, it sounds like it's the tune for an old Meatloaf song, if anybody's familiar with Meatloaf, but amen. It's all good for Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Okay, well, let's go right to the Word of God this morning. You know, Wednesday night, we were talking about, you know, a lot of the anxiety and so forth, some of the very things Tim was talking about again this morning, and thanks again, Tim, because a lot of the things you said just kind of set up the segue into what I want to speak to you about this morning. But, you know, the idea that we can get all stressed out and freaked out over elections and the current kind of attitudes that are going on in the world right here in the city of Des Moines and all around the world for that matter. A lot of hatred, a lot of craziness. But just remember, God's there. He's not the author of any of it, but he's right here in the midst of it. And the only way we're ever going to really be able to deal with it is, the scripture says to have your minds renewed by the Word of God. And that doesn't mean we just dig through here and try to find something that'll fit what our agenda is, but we actually look to see what it is that God's trying to say to us. You know, and on the one hand, Jesus was a very simplistic person. I mean, in the sense that he was just transparent. But at the same time, he was deeper than deep, you know, and so the Word of God is the same, because obviously he is the Word. And that's what I'd like to talk to you about this morning. And I'd like to cause you to question, you know, and to question. Questions are not bad, because questions make you look for answers, you know. And that's what the Bible is all about, giving us answers to life. answers to the big questions in life and answers to eternal life. And I think it's kind of odd that we've turned it into trying to make it fit into our particular doctrine or denomination or whatever, when it's for everybody, for all time, for every situation. So just bear with me if I get a little weird on you this morning. But, you know, the heck, nothing new there, right? All right, so let's start, Sheila, if you will, John chapter 1, verse 1, and then 14, which I know you can't put up at the same time. So John 1, 1 first. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now keep that in your mind here this morning. Then, if you will, Sheila, go to 1 John 1:1. So in the beginning was the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. And that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. So the Bible, based on that, just put it into my words here, the Bible is God's word in human words. Okay? God's word in human words. Just imagine this, if you will. There's a well-known preacher. He just finishes a sermon. It's heard by thousands of people and some huge arena, and then thousands more on TV and radio. And the preacher's walking out the backstage door after the message when a dozen of his key backers, who have been with him since he was a complete unknown, corner him, and they say, "Tell us again what you said." They say, "Tell us, what exactly were you trying to say this morning? We didn't understand a thing." Well, that'd be troubling, wouldn't it? Look at Matthew chapter 13, verse 36 through 43. Matthew 13, 36 through 43. And the disciples are in the same situation when they come to Jesus and they say, "Declare to us," or "tell us, explain to us what you're talking about." He sent the multitudes away and went into the house, and his disciples came unto him, saying, "Declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field." He had just given this parable. And he answered and said unto them, "He that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send for his angels. They shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and them which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear." And I don't know about you, but I don't understand a whole lot more now than I did before. Jesus was never overly concerned if people didn't always get it. And I can tell you, as a pastor and having done some evangelism over the years, it can freak you out when people come up to you after the service and start asking you questions that you don't even know where they're coming from. You know, I mean, you thought you laid it all out there, and then they come and say things, and you go, "What in the world did I just say?" You know? But a lot of times, Jesus left listeners puzzled. He left them perturbed and upset. He left them with loose ends, with no real resolutions. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7. And Jesus is talking about the spoken mysteries, or we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. So there's a key element in any mystery, and it's that the little we know draws our attention and draws us deeper into it. It engages our imagination. That's why we love mysteries. We may see in a glass darkly, but we really do see. Matthew 18, verses 3 and 4. And I'll just want to give you some insight here, hopefully. He said, "Verily, I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever there shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." And we know that Jesus was always saying, "Suffer the children to come unto me." The disciples are going to get them out of here. And, you know, they're pain, they're causing a disruption here. And Jesus was always saying, "Just let them come. Just let them come to me." And here's the reason. The first century Jewish view of children was the polar opposite of our modern view. We see them as innocent. Am I wrong? Unless you have one, praise the Lord. But children weren't thought of as innocent in Judaism. In fact, they were thought of as, under the fall of Adam, inclined to evil and without help until they became bar mitzvah at the age of 13, where they would receive the help of the law. Now, bar mitzvah actually means son of commandment. Bar means son. You know, Simon bar Jonah. He's Simon, the son of Jonah. So bar mitzvah means son of commandment or son of the law. So at the age of 13, they become sons of the law. Now the law can help them, whereas before, they were evil. They were outside of it, right? So Jesus is saying to become an evil child was the pathway to greatness. Now, don't think that didn't mess up the minds of people that were living in that first century Judaism. What he was saying was, instead of coming to the law, instead of being a son of the law, come unto me. Come to the Son of Love. Come to grace. That's why he said, let him come. Let him come. I want them to be free. I want them to be innocent. And the only way that's going to happen is if they come to me. The law is going to point out all your flaws. Yes. And I'm just going to embrace them and accept them as innocent. See, it's about opening the mind of human words to God's word. We say, why didn't this happen? I tried. Try harder. I tried harder. I failed. Try harder. I've been trying as hard as I can. I can't try anymore. I give up. Good. Galatians 2, 19 to 21. We've all been there. We did everything we thought we were supposed to do. We tried as hard as we could, and we still screwed up. Jesus said, "You're finally where I'm looking for you to be, at the place where you just give up trying, where you stop trying to do it and trust me. Just come to me, you evil little child, and I'll embrace you as a son of love. I'll declare you to be innocent by my grace. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness came by the law, then Christ is dead in vain." Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. What shall we then say to Abraham? Okay, what shall we say then that Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? Well, Abraham was before the law. There was no law. What did he find before the law? If Abraham were justified by works, he had something to be, to glory in. But not before God. For what saith the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. So God's word, in human words, discloses truth. But it also discloses the heart of the person that's listening to it or reading it. How much they want the truth. I'm depressing you now, aren't I? But I've seen it over and over. People pick out a scripture, they'll use that scripture to manipulate or to control or to prove their point. But the scripture is to take us deeper into that reality, to cause us to question, to cause us to search, to cause us to go deeper than to just accept whatever is our agenda is. So it's all about how it's framed. Conversations, look, I know words, you know. I was an English major, not a great student, but I love language. But if I get ticked off, it all goes out the window, and I just become an idiot. And just whatever comes into my head is what I end up saying, because I'm just trying to prove my point now. I'm not trying to be consistent with what I believe. So Jesus reframes reality. He completely reframes the reality for each and every one of us. And Saul's a perfect example. Tim was talking about it. Saul had been he'd been secure in the Jewish tradition, in Judaism, in the class structure, in the fact that he was a Pharisee of Pharisees, and all of these things. And now he has to reject it because a whole new reality centered in Jesus is opening up right before him. And it, you know, in the words of the Bible, he was blinded by it. He was dumbfounded by it. What do you want me to do, Lord? You know, because in his mind, he thought, I'm doing everything that I'm supposed to be doing. He had the same Bible that Jesus had. All the Old Testament, right? Now the living word comes and tells him everything you've been doing is upside down and backwards. Right? God's word in human words shows up. The living word. Galatians chapter 3, 10 through 14. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it's written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it's evident. For the just shall live by faith. The law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it's written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. That the blessing of Abraham might come unto the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Romans chapter 8, verse 33. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifieth. Verse 38 and 39. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, I don't know what anybody else is going through, what your issues are, what your personal things and all that, but I'm just telling you, God's on your side. No matter how much you are convinced you've failed, no matter how much you convince the enemy has tried to convince you that you're a loser or that you've got nothing going for you and you don't know what's happening and why you keep screwing everything up. I'll tell you a story. I'm a great Mark Twain fan. My wife will tell you I've got books upon books. I've got half a dozen biographies and I've got probably just about everything he's ever written. There's one that fascinates me though, and I read it to the grandkids all the time, is Tom Sawyer. I scare them with the ones where they're in the cave, scare them to sleep is what I do. But I read them to the kids all the time, because I think it's great literature, and I think it reveals so much of life, subliminally, you know. But Tom Sawyer is told by his aunt that he has to whitewash this fence. It's kind of a punishment, but it's just, you know, normal parental discipline. And, of course, Tom Sawyer is a lazy slug. I mean, all he wants to do is fish and sneak off in the alley and smoke old cigar butts or something, you know. I mean, that's the kind of kid he is. He's just a typical kid, you know. But his aunt gives him this job, and he has to do it before he can go play. And it's to whitewash a fence. So Tom, being a student of the Bible, I think, frames the job he's supposed to do. He frames it attractively. He pretends to like the work. And all of his buddies are coming around saying, come on, we're going down to fish, and we're going to go swim, you know, we're going to go down to the river. And he said, no, are you kidding? I'm whitewashing the fence. So he pretends to like it, and the kids are going, like it? And he tells the kid says, what do you mean you like it? He said, I like it. I don't see why I oughtn't to like it. Not every day does a boy get the chance to whitewash a fence. And he dabs at it a little bit, and then he stands back and looks at it like it's the Mona Lisa, you know, like it's this great work of art. And he dabs a little more, admires his work. His friends get more and more absorbed in it. And they say, Tom, could I whitewash a little bit? Tom says, well, wait a minute. You know, this is a chance in a lifetime. And you want me to just give it up and let you do it? Oh, come on, Tom, give us a shot. Let us have a chance. Not only is the fence whitewashed, but Tom whitewashes the hard work of painting into something that his buddies all of a sudden find irresistible. He's framed the conversation. He's framed the way it's presented. So look at James chapter 1, verse 22. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. So, reframing happens best when we move from being passive observers to active participants. Jesus, the Word, isn't so much presenting an outline, but instead he's drawing the listener into an experience. He's not just giving us something to study for a test, but he's giving us something that we can experience. The Word, God's Word, becomes real through man's words. God becomes flesh and reveals the glory of God. He frames God in a whole nother way, a way that hadn't been seen before, a way that hadn't been understood before. Jesus, the Word, isn't so much presenting an outline, but he's trying to draw us into an experience. Luke chapter 15, verse 11 through 16. Familiar story, it's about the prodigal son, but I wonder if we have ever looked at it the way Jesus was presenting it. So he said a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided them unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey. And I want you to notice something. He gave it to both of them. Right? He divided it unto them, his goods. The younger son is the one that came and wanted it. But when he asked for it, he gave it to both of them. Because he got a brother, right? So he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. When he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. Now, I doubt that any of the Pharisees, and there were Pharisees all there, that's what the the whole thing was about. They were complaining about all these jerks, these sinners, these tax collectors and everybody that Jesus was hanging out with. And so the Pharisees, they were listening to Jesus. And they saw themselves as something other than what Jesus was talking about. In other words, they didn't see themselves as the prodigal son. They're listening to the story, but they're sure that I'm not the prodigal, right? We're not the prodigal sons. And since it wasn't their story, they could listen as spectators. This is a huge lesson. We can hear the scriptures and read the scriptures as listeners without being participants. And Jesus is trying to draw us into an experience. He wants us to experience Him, the living Word, God's Word in flesh. Not as spectators. Despising the prodigal, see, since it wasn't their story, they could just be spectators. They weren't the prodigal. They could despise the prodigal and his rebellion. And they could be happy and feel justified that he suffered the consequences. In fact, the prodigal sounded a lot like these riffraff that Jesus was hanging out with. That Jesus welcomed. All right, look at Luke 15, verse 22 through 28. I love it when people look through the scriptures to find something about me that they don't like. There's plenty in here. So they can fix me. Save your breath. My wife's been trying for 36 years, and it hasn't worked yet. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him. This is when the rebellious son, the prodigal son, comes home. Put it on him. Put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now his elder son, who was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants, and he asked, what's going on? What do these things mean? And he said unto him, thy brother has come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. Now Jesus catches the Pharisees off guard when he introduces the older brother, representing them. And in fact, the real focus of the story. Always with the Father, but never understanding His compassion, never understanding His mercy, never understanding His love or His grace. Jesus leaves the story open-ended. He doesn't give them a clear-cut, this is what you got to do, this is what you shouldn't do, this is, you know, follow the storyline here. So He leaves it open-ended, and He tells the story at this welcome home party for tax collectors and sinners. Younger brothers. And here's the open-ended question that Jesus leaves. Will the Pharisees join in the party and Jesus, or remain outside angry? We can look at it now and say, well, that's the Pharisees. I'm the prodigal. See, we're everything in here. He's not wanting us just to get information. He's wanting to draw us into an experience,
yes,
that's life-changing, an experience in God.
Yes.
So, John 1:14 again. In the beginning was the Word was with God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So we started this morning with God's Word in man's words. Every act of God, every word of God, God is slowly weaning us from making him in our image instead of us being created in his image. Like believing that holy, being set apart, is something that we do for God instead of something God is and does in us. It's a mystery we inhabit. It's not just looked at and asked questions out of curiosity. If God's word is doing its work, it'll cause us to ask questions. Not theological exhibits that we look at. No. We inhabit it, and that opens us up to God's mystery. We inhabit bodies with minds and emotions at the same time, wallowing like pigs and soaring like eagles. That's what we are. Created a little lower than the angels, and yet like grass that soon passes away. We discover a personal God, incredibly close, and yet he transcends the universe. We grow in knowledge, and we reach a point, we begin to inhabit the mystery. No longer using this to judge ourselves or to criticize others, but to find ourselves in him, accepted in the beloved. We grow in knowledge. When we reach a point, we begin to inhabit this mystery in which we live and move and have our being. God's word in human words, the mystery becomes knowable. The word becomes flesh. And that's my message for you this morning. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.